Might want to remember to mute yourself when you're not talking.
Thank you for tuning in to Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like you've never been before. And when I say we, I mean me and my very knowledgeable panel of automotive journalists sitting in the film strip below. Later on, we'll have a special report from one of our regulars, Mr. Greg Morrison, who's sitting in the press room at the LA Auto Show. He spent last couple of days out there. But before we get into that, I want to introduce you to a brand new product from Auto Network. It's called Auto Network Wi-Fi. This is our intelligent router. That's why I'm not out there in LA with you, Greg, working on this. It's a plug and play. It comes with an Ethernet cable, power supply, and a surge protector. Creates a free Wi-Fi in your place of business, so now you can make more sales to mobile shoppers in and around your business. So contact me, that's Roosevelt, to get your Auto Network Wi-Fi, our very, very intelligent router. Look for information to contact me in the description for this particular show. So that's out of the way. Let's have the panelists introduce themselves. Russ, where are you and what are you doing, man?
Hi, I'm Russ Heaps, and I'm coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina. I've been in this business covering the car industry for about 25 years. I've done it for newspapers, magazines, and now, not surprisingly, some dot-coms. And I'm also the editor of the brand new website, GreenvilleInsider.com, that tells you all about Greenville, South Carolina.
Linda.
Hi, I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from lovely Mayberry, USA, well, a stone's throw from there, and pleased to report it's a balmy 52 degrees outside here today, unlike the 11 it was yesterday morning. And like Russ, I've been in this business between 20 and 25 years. I've written for major newspapers, major magazines. I have a website with a blog. I invite you to visit sharpdriver.com. There you can find all sorts of car reviews, and if you want to go back into some vintage history racing, you'll find a lot of a gallery of my race photos and the people that I hung around with. One with skinny legs who had the initials PLN, so you might find that interesting. And glad to be here today and can't wait to hear what Greg has to tell us about what went on at the LA Auto Show.
Greg.
Good afternoon. This is Greg Morrison. I'm in Atlanta, right? Normally I'm in Atlanta, but today I'm in Los Angeles at the press room for the LA Auto Show, where I've been running like a crazy man for the last 2.5 days. A lot of things going on here, a lot of technology, and some interesting positioning by the automakers on various platforms. We'll have fun and a chance to talk about that later today. I own Bumper to Bumper TV, a weekly video vignette with reviews and news on the auto industry. So let's have some fun today.
Great. Thank all of you for introducing yourselves. And I think we're all coming out of we're now into a thaw. It was about 14 degrees here where I am in Charlotte. And I think, Linda, you said you had, around 11 degrees?
11.
What'd you have, Russ?
I think we got down to about 19.
Oh, man.
It was warm here, warm.
What'd you have in Atlanta, Greg?
When I left on Monday, it was 22 degrees. My son was cursing me for making him get up and take me to the airport. But I got here, and it's 56. In fact, it was 74 the other day. And I was breaking out in a sweat, and I loved every second of it.
Well, I guess we could all be in Buffalo, right? And they're getting about 100, let's say 100 inches in the last 3 or 4 days, which is more than what they get in a year. Can you imagine that? That is unbelievable. Yeah, unbelievable. But anyway, in the news, Volvo is testing a package delivery system with DHL. And if you know what DHL is, it's one of those services similar to, what's the one, UPS, and what's the other one?
FedEx.
And now this is a twist. You can have, and they're testing this in Germany. As a matter of fact, they have been testing it, and it's been very successful. Volvo has some technology in their car whereby if you're getting a package from DHL, most of us, as you know, aren't home when packages are delivered. A lot of times you have to sign for them. DHL can send you a text message. You okay the text. They locate your car wherever it's parked. And they can literally, DHL can literally open the door one time, deposit the package, and lock the door. Now, they've done this with regular packages, and now they're experimenting with groceries. What do you think?
Just don't be coming out of the meeting. Your groceries will go spoil.
I'm speechless. I can't even imagine a car company going to the trouble to do this. I'm not sure that there's that much demand, or somebody might buy a Volvo because they can have their package delivered to the car instead of their house. I don't know. But on the other hand, can you get it? Do they open the trunk? Do they put it in the car, in the trunk? What do they do? I wouldn't want a package sitting in my car parked, who knows where, for hours.
It would depend on the type of car. Obviously, if you have a trunk, they pop, they can open the car, open the trunk, deposit the package, and lock it up. Now, they can only do it one time, so they don't get to keep the code and be able to do it two or three times the next week. But I found it very interesting that, like you said, Russ, a car company even going to that extent. And it's other car companies have apps where you can open the car doors, you can start the engine remotely from literally anywhere in the world. But this is the first time I've heard where they're working with another company to deliver packages to you in your car.
There's something about a total stranger dropping something in my car that would make me a little nervous. It just, you've heard of Murphy's Law? I guess it would, if you have a really expensive car, an unscrupulous person might be saying, oh, this is my shot, or, I don't know. I'm with Russ. I'm really surprised that someone even came up with this concept.
We always talk about technology in cars, and every time you turn around, at least once or twice a week, I get some email notice or some news or, newsletter that's talking about how people are using technologies. And car companies are right up there at the forefront of using technologies to provide better services and customer service to their owners or future owners.
Well, GM has a Skunk Works out in California. I've been there. I can't remember which little beach town it's in anymore, but where they've got about 25 eggheads sitting around looking at other technology that doesn't have anything to do with cars, but stuff for your home and your office and whatever, and they're trying to figure out ways to apply that technology to cars. And bring it into cars, and all I can think of is Volvo must have something comparable to that, and I guess it must have been a slow day, and they said, hey, why don't we come up with some way they can deliver a package to a car?
When Greg gets into his little piece, I'm sure he'll be talking about some new technologies that some of the car companies have introduced at LA. But moving right along, we've had a lot of conversation. There's been a lot of ink, a lot of video about these airbags in cars that are causing some serious injuries to people as well as actually killing folks. Now, Honda's taken a different approach. What Honda's doing, they're offering to replace airbags for any concerned customer, whether it was a part of a recall or not. So if you own a Honda and you don't think that you don't want to risk your airbag being one of those that has the problem, take it into your local Honda, well, call and make an appointment first at your local Honda dealer, and they will actually replace that airbag. Now, that's a customer service. I think that's top of the line for customer service. What do you guys think?
Well, for Honda, it's a brilliant move because they, like everyone else, got stuck with those Takata airbags. In fact, one of the top execs of Takata was testifying before Congress this morning. I saw that before I hit the show floor. And it strikes me that this is a very proactive move, but more importantly, it is basically trying to get the onus off of the company before it bites them on the backside, literally, with a lawsuit or like a General Motors-type lawsuit. Will other manufacturers follow suit? It's hard to say. and everyone's pointing the finger back at Takata, who seems to be doing the left-handed salute, saying, well, the Feds told us to do this, that, and the other. There's some bigger issues there. This is like putting a Band-Aid on a gunshot wound in terms of safety for the auto industry.
I have a friend who has a Honda Element that he loves the car. He's just been thrilled with it. Unfortunately, he lives, or fortunately, depending on your point of view, he lives on the panhandle of Florida. And I know it's been in the news a lot that's about the worst climate that you can possibly be in, to a humid climate, for these airbags to fail. And he finally got to the Honda dealer, and they replaced the one airbag that is in the steering wheel. But now he's really concerned about all the other airbags, because they have a similar rubber bladder, and he's actually considering selling his car because he's nervous. He says, I'm just not comfortable in the car. So I don't know if this is going to turn out to be a can of worms for the manufacturers, that people are going to get nervous about other airbags. It's a mess. Just a mess.
I think it's more than a can of worms. it's a serious threat,
yeah,
to your life and family and bodily injury.
He was telling me there was a woman, I believe it was in Ohio, that she bumped another car in a parking lot, and there was no visible external damage to this Honda Accord, but the airbag deployed and the shrapnel came out and it slit her throat, and they initially investigated it as a homicide because they thought someone had murdered her in her car, until they realized the airbag had went off and the shrapnel had slit her throat. So.
Yeah, my question is, well, can you imagine the scope of something like that across the line? Also, people want to sell these cars. Would you want to buy one? I know I sure wouldn't.
Yeah.
Well, we're moving right along to Russ's favorite topic, and that's fuel cells. Toyota introduced the Mirai. I guess that's how you pronounce it. It's a $57,500 fuel cell vehicle, Russ. They're going to have 200 in California next year, 2015. What do you think, buddy?
You know, interestingly, I just did a fuel cell story for a client, so I'm kind of boned up on all this stuff. But I am telling you, despite the fact that there are only two or three companies right now that seem to really be grabbing the bull by the horns and moving forward with getting cars into showrooms, Hyundai already has some fuel cell Tucsons in the hands of consumers on the road. Toyota's coming out in 2015, Honda in 2016, early in 2016. GM is talking perhaps 2020, having some fuel cells vehicles in showrooms. It's coming. It's the only thing that really makes sense for electric. It's the only thing that makes sense for electric right now.
I don't know if you're familiar, if you remember Joel Ivanek. I guess that's how you pronounce his last name. But he was in PR at a couple of the car companies, and now he's heading up this company that's building these hydrogen refueling stations, and I think he's gotten, I forgot who he got the funding from to install an enormous number of these hydrogen refueling stations out in the California area.
Well, Toyota just struck a deal with some company that makes these things to help them get a bunch of them up the northeast corridor from, Manhattan all the way up to Rhode Island, where they're going to be spotted every 150, 200 miles. So somebody in a fuel cell car that's expected to have a 300-mile range can make that run without any difficulty. I was told by the GM folks that there are a bunch of hydrogen stations in Hawaii, which I hadn't even heard of. But so it's happening. The infrastructure's coming, and the car companies, I think, are going to get a little more aggressive in marketing some fuel cell vehicles.
Well, talking about marketing and being aggressive, Lincoln is not going away. As a matter of fact, Lincoln just came out with what they call the Black Label. It's a $5,300 package that you can get And I think they have something like what they call four different themes that you can get for Lincoln. And they've signed up about 32 so far Lincoln dealers for this program. You get special upholstery, you get special seats for a little over $5,300 for a Lincoln Black Label. The dealer has to have a special room to deliver the car and to talk about the car, to have salespeople that are trained specifically for the Black Label. I think that's going to help Lincoln.
They got to do something. They got to do something. I mean, the transition over to the crossover platforms for their, well, it had traditionally been their limo platform, has not gone as well as they'd like. I just came past their stand here on the floor here, and it looks nice, but there's not a lot of excitement with the vehicles that they're offering, at least not yet. Going with this level of exclusivity and panache and this, that, and the other will help a little bit, you know, as a positioning it as a luxury brand. The question is, after you have all the pretty girls and the pretty lights, what do you really have in terms of a vehicle that will stand up against a Lexus, against a Mercedes, against an Audi? And I don't see them quite becoming the supercar yet that can stand up against those platforms.
I wish Lincoln well, and you know, they're going to have to come up, pull some a marketing rabbit out of the hat, I think, to really make some headway. And I don't think Matthew McConaughey is that rabbit. But you know, it's not that they make bad vehicles. They just are not exciting vehicles, or haven't been in the past, and for the past few years. And they got to do something besides gussy up some Fords. And they seem to be heading in that direction, but that's kind of been the problem for the last 10 or 15 years.
Well, maybe they should follow what Subaru is doing, because Subaru can't seem to do anything wrong. You know, they have the programs where they sponsor all these green events, and they have these programs where I think they talk about pets and dogs, and everybody loves a good dog story. Mm-hmm. And it looks like Subaru is going to meet their U.S. sales objective of 600,000 vehicles 3 years earlier than projected. So hooray for Subaru. They're doing everything right, it looks like, with little to no effort. They're doing it so well, it seems like it's little to no effort.
From your description of the weather in the Northeast, Subaru could do no wrong up in that area right now.
Right.
I'd like to just say one thing more about Lincoln. Not very long ago, I had an MKZ, and there was a lot about the car that I found, you know, I wasn't so sure about. I'm still not convinced about the push buttons on the, you know, to the right side of the steering wheel on the dashboard. It sort of reminded me of a Dodge Dart I rode in when I was in high school, but the push buttons were on the left with that. It was a very comfortable car. It had a lot of room in it. There's no mistaking the bird-like grill to it. But the thing that was really surprising to me was how strong that V6 ran. I mean, it was just a little screaming banshee. You know, I think maybe Lincoln's challenge is to get the consumer behind the wheel and get them to experience the car. But I agree completely with Greg that if you look at the ambiance inside the car, I mean, you compare... I think this MKZ was $53,000. Now that's, you know, it's $10,000 less than a Hyundai Genesis, but it's worlds apart, you know. And you go back to the special editions, like I know somebody in town here had an old Lincoln Town Car that was an Arnold Palmer edition, and it had really cushy white leather seats, and it was, you know, it was emerald green like the Augusta thing, and it had the white vinyl roof, but it had a panache to it. And I think Russ hit on this too, that, you know, there's a little bit of a panache. So I'll be interested to see what this Black Label is. Maybe they're going to move in that direction, because I do think they're going to have to elevate the interior of their car. While they're very nice now, they're not in the same league with some of the people that they would like to be competitive with.
I'm all for these fancy trim packages, and I think there's some market for that, but the cars that are really successful in the luxury in that kind of affordable luxury segment, and I'm not talking Bentleys, and I'm not talking Lamborghinis, but I'm talking Audis and Mercedes and BMWs, and even Cadillac now. They have done it with performance. I mean, that is really, that's their key. Once Cadillac got that North Star engine and started marketing that as almost a separate brand, and have come out with this V-series of performance versions of quite a few of the products in their lineup, that is what's kind of catapulted them. Audi, Mercedes, BMW, Porsche, all the same. I don't think you can build a luxury brand with V6s. I just don't think you can do it.
That and design. I mean, you really have to be spot on with design these days. Obviously, that's the first thing that somebody sees is what the car looks like. But Land Rover won the top honors for three-year ALG residuals. ALG is the company that sets the residuals for different products. And Land Rover took the top honors. It's something that they haven't done. I don't think they've done before. So we want to say kudos to Land Rover. And that sport helped push them right over the top. As a matter of fact, ALG, we're trying to get the new president of ALG on the show. He used to be with Chrysler. Shot him a couple of emails because I'd like to have a show to talk about leasing and residual values, how to calculate them and all that good stuff. But a lot of people, as you know, are leasing cars nowadays. And we still have more recalls, folks. Ford's recalling 65,000 Fusions because the key may be removed without the car being in park. And those are the 2014 and 2015 models of the Fusion. Anybody out there own a Fusion? Nope.
At least no one's admitting to it.
Well, let's move right into our special correspondent. And now we have correspondents literally from around the world. We have our first one out in L.A., and we'll go to Germany next. And that's Greg Morrison. And it's amazing that we can do something like this, and I'm surprised more businesses aren't doing it. You can literally have somebody sitting in Antarctica, as long as they have an internet connection, they can be on this show, and they can do it for free. I mean, this is not a mobile truck, a million-dollar mobile broadcasting truck that's doing this. We're doing things that major studios, you know, TV stations are doing on a daily basis. We can do anytime we want with a couple of cameras, a laptop, and a microphone.
It goes back to the old days of hip-hop. You say two turntables and a mic, and you're good.
Yeah, I remember last year, Greg, at the L.A. Auto Show, I was walking around holding a laptop. We had two headsets plugged in, and we were talking to Russ, and we had the ladies on the show.
Oh, by the way, Russ, they asked for you.
On the stands, saying hi to Russ. Russ was beat red.
How are you getting this year, Russ?
It made my day.
And not just one, we had about four or five of them saying hi to Russ.
Yeah, it was fun and games.
But anyway, what's happening, Greg, in L.A.? What's hot?
The big thing this year is connected car technology. We discussed earlier, everybody wrapping their arms around it in some form or fashion. There's not been an introduction without mention of connectivity, connected car technology, being able to use your smartphone, whether it's an iPhone, an Android, or even a tablet, to connect to your car, take your programs that are on that device that will translate up into the big screen on your car so that, think about it, a manufacturer will say, I'll use Kia, for example. Instead of having to upgrade their navigation system and their audio system every few years with the latest, greatest, all you get to do is have an app that can be written and updated via the internet. Boom, it appears on the screen. It's operable. I spent some time with a guy from Google. who was working on some things for Hyundai. They're moving to the level of connectivity such that with an Android phone, especially since Google is very tied into that, it will take your navigation system, it will take your calendar, put everything on the screen, and then it'll integrate with Hyundai's existing BlueLink system in terms of maintenance for the car. What we have come to is, we've all discussed on this before, is your smartphone is literally going to become the brains behind your car. A few minutes ago, Mitsubishi showed us a concept vehicle, and one of the things they stressed was connectivity, the ability to be able to use smart devices to connect it and make it much more option full. And think about it. Your spin-up cost used to be 3 to 5 years. You're talking something that can be done in months now. And once it's approved, just download the app. Fewer trips back and forth to the dealership to get more of these things fixed because they're all on your phone. That's one of the things that got attention here. We talked earlier.
Let me ask you a quick question, Greg, about that. Did they mention anything about privacy or security?
That's one of the big conversations about who's watching your data. Is it just you watching your data? But if it's in a cloud, who's got access to that cloud to know that, you know, I'm calling Linda every other day at a certain time? Or who's got access to the cloud to know who I'm sending a text message to? And that's a big concern, and the industry is painfully aware of it, and thanks in large part to folks like Mr. Snowden, they're very painfully aware of how we have to safeguard that information. I may send you a text about something that is only for your eyes, but if it's in the cloud, what's to stop it from being distributed to folks who really don't need to know that? I may express an opinion, and not that we don't express our opinions here on this show, that is not necessarily consumable in mixed company. Those are the kind of things that people have to be concerned about, that the manufacturers are concerned about, the software developers are vitally concerned about. Software is coming online now that, again, you don't have to have it embedded in the car for parental control of the car, so that when their teenager is driving it, they'll know not only how fast they're going, they'll know where they are. Between that, geofencing, and some other restrictions that can put on the car, sitting at home with a smartphone, so Junior takes out my brand new car, well, you can go 35 miles an hour, you can go in this area, and I'll know if you even went down a certain block where this guy lives that, or girl lives that you shouldn't be hanging out with. It is coming together faster and faster.
Now, Greg, I know you're there at press days. This is not for the general public yet. But what's been the... has the show had great attendance from the media, and what seems to be the hot product that everybody wants to take a look at?
Maybach. Mercedes has basically brought back that Maybach label once again. We're going to make it part of an integrated Mercedes offering. That drew a lot of buzz. Audi showing off their hydrogen-capable vehicles and their whole suite of vehicles. Volkswagen with the Rabbit and the things that they do, the Golf rather, not the Rabbit, forgive me. And the things they're doing with that, with multiple iterations, you'll have a performance version, you'll have an electric version, you'll have a hybrid at some point, you'll have a regular gasoline version. It is interesting. Ford, you know, thumping their chest hard, saying, hey, we've got an Explorer that you really want to go because we've got this brand new, you know, EcoBoost engine that'll get much better mileage, and even though it's a big vehicle, with gasoline prices down below $3 a gallon, even here in Los Angeles, believe it or not, the idea of SUVs becomes appealing once again. Your friends over at Honda actually got my attention with something they did. They showed off the HR-V, which is a CR-V on steroids. It's a bigger, more comfortable vehicle, and you know, they're saying they know there's that sweet spot for the crossover that's a little bigger than the CR-V. I don't know if you got any of the pictures that I sent you, but Russ, they got a Cadillac here with your name on it.
Yeah, I'm gonna pull those up in a little bit, but I want to, Russ, you and Linda can chime in with any questions that you may have.
I don't have any.
Greg, do you think that the motivation behind the automakers are moving towards Russ's favorite entity, the fuel cell vehicles or the electric vehicles, or, you know, is this because that's where their heart is, or is this because they're trying to meet the new CAFE standards?
A little of both, but the other thing is they're smart enough to recognize that millennials, the inclusive buyer group they're trying to get to, are more than willing to embrace this technology. The research is showing that folks who are in their late 20s, early 30s, i.e. my daughter, are looking for more efficient, earth-friendly, for lack of a better term, uses of fuel to propel vehicles. And when you start talking electric vehicles, and you start talking about fuel cell, you're getting their attention. It's almost to the point that a hybrid is considered passé now. Ah, there it is. That's the Hyundai stand I was telling you about. Now, how many manufacturers do you know are willing to dance with both Apple and Google for their in-car connectivity systems? This will give you an idea of how serious they are. They had reps from Apple in one car, Google in another, explaining the technology and really, really pushing it. And you notice Blue Link is in the middle. All of it is coming together as a suite of offerings. This is just the beginning of the change. It reminds me somewhat of when we thought CD players were going to be the thing. Guess what? Probably within 3 years, you won't even be able to get a CD player in a car.
Now, Greg, are stands like this getting a lot of play from the national media that's there, or is it just okay? That sounds good. Let's move on.
No, it's getting busy down there, especially on Tuesday before the show opened, before the reveals opened. It was very crowded down there in terms of getting in to talk to people, because you not only have traditional media, you have trade press and bloggers who are coming in saying, "Oh, I want to check this out." Because this is a technology that is really within their wheelhouse. For folks who are wedded to smartphones and wedded to portable devices, this really rings true. It was funny because a few years ago I'd come to Connected Car and it would be one corner. Now it is taking up the entire lobby, South Lobby out here, Roosevelt, and you know how big that South Lobby is, right, where they do Car of the Year. In fact, when they did Green Car of the Year, they had to squeeze it into a corner of the South Lobby this morning, because of the connected car technology was all over the place.
Now, this Hyundai stand, when the general public comes in, will they actually be able to sit in these cars and play with the technology?
I believe so, and they're going to leave a lot of it up for the general public to be able to come in and experience and play with the technology and talk to the folks from these various manufacturers about it. That is the fuel cell from Toyota, the Mirage. This thing is the other unspoken star of the show. People are flocking to it just out of curiosity. They like the look of it. They say some are a little put off by it, but the technology is what's drawing attention. Millennials. I mean, look at the people standing behind it. Those are 20-somethings, early 30-somethings who are willing to adopt this kind of technology. And Russ, you are so on target with this. This is the way to go. Methane
Russ
gas
is the man. He be the man.
Oh, Russ is the man.
But he always has been.
Think
now,
about
Greg,
it. Methane,
Greg, does this car seat 4 or 5?
It'll seat 4 right now. Eventually, you can probably get 5 with a little adjustment. Of course, that means that I won't be able to sit in the back seat because there's a little more of me around than there should be.
And they announced a price with this today, or when they uncovered it.
They announced the price earlier in the week.
Did they?
Yeah, $57,500.
Totally missed it. I'm amazed that they're doing it for that price. They're able to do it for that price.
But well,
you can't refuel it, so what are you going to do?
Wrong. You can refuel it here in Southern California.
I'm just kidding.
There are hydrogen stations here. And remember, Hyundai started the ball rolling about a year ago with the Tucson, you know, using their dealership points as refueling stations. Now Shell is getting into the game and offering hydrogen refueling stations. And one of the guys from Audi was telling me that you can refuel from empty to full in 3 minutes with hydrogen.
Yep.
That's quick. Yeah. That and the range.
Yeah, 342 miles on a full charge. Yeah. Works for me.
Hey, you could go to the bus barn at MARTA and get hydrogen. They've had hydrogen on the buses in Atlanta for a decade, I guess.
Well, actually, it's propane in Atlanta.
Oh, is it propane? Okay.
Yeah. but the concept is the same, the compressed gas. So do not be surprised if you start seeing hydrogen popping up in cities. Volvo showed off, this is the redesigned V60 sport wagon. They also had a XC60 crossover that they were talking about with this technology to be able to see pedestrians in advance. Very high tech in terms of integrated connectivity with your smartphone device, and very much of an emphasis on safety. Volvo and safety makes sense. And I'm glad to see this happening, because one of my concerns is when the company was sold to the Chinese that they had cut back on this kind of research. They seem to be going the other direction, you know, really pushing it because they recognize that is their market. And this was in the connected car sequence, not on the show floor where they had all this set up. Right behind them, you can see the Continental Tire display. Even Continental Tire is getting into some of this stuff. These guys make tires.
Which car company did off-site intros and didn't have cars physically in the building at the convention center? Were there any of those this year?
Ford did an off-site intro for the Shelby. They put one on the floor, but they wouldn't let you raise the hood. Mazda did an off-site intro to show off the new CX-3. And it was a nice party. They finally got it down to the show floor. For the most part, you know, no one did anything really crazy off-site that you couldn't see downtown. It was just not worth it to them. I found it fascinating that Mazda is going full head-on with the new design language, retweaking the CX-3, retweaking the CX-5, the Mazda 6, getting new fascia, and of course, they showed off their 2016 MX-5. A wonderful-looking car. I hope it drives as good as it looks.
Now, did you do any throwing back with Hyundai at the Figueroa Hotel?
I had one for you, and one for Russ, no, two for Russ, and one for Linda, and one for me.
That's what I hate. I miss was that's the hotel where I normally stay when I'm out there.
Yeah, it was a nice party last night. It had a great band, a lot of good fellowship with people, and the nicest part is you weren't having executives press you about talking cars. You just have a good time, as always. Right now, you're looking at a concept car from Infiniti.
Whoa.
Pretty. Yeah.
Pretty.
I'm talking about the car.
Yeah, I Downers. See. Oh, Downers. I thought you were talking about that left leg that was dragging over there on the right side.
Down, Russ.
You see he's propped up there getting closer and closer.
Hey. I'm here to defend Russ.
So this is, do you know whether this is a 8 or a 6 or what?
Yeah, I think it'll be an 8 or a 10.
Ooh.
I mean, it's absolutely breathtaking. Can you imagine rolling down the street in one of these?
It is gorgeous.
It is.
Now if they just build them. The Maybach. The Mercedes Maybach. They're putting it in the with the S-Classes. I mean, it's just a beautiful platform. It is breathtaking is the best way to describe it. I didn't get a chance to get in the back seat of it because every time I'd go over there to get pictures, you know, I had to fight the foreign press, the German press, who were all over the car.
Now, I don't know whether you went to the original launch of the Maybach in 2002 in New York. Did any of you go to that?
No, I didn't get any chance to do that.
Okay, they brought the Maybach in on top of the Q2 ship. Cruise, what's that, a luxury cruise ship?
Yeah.
It was the final voyage of the QE2.
And
coming under the Verrazano Bridge, they had us out on several boats right out there by the Statue of Liberty. QE2 came in a glass container on top. The Maybach was in a glass container on top of the boat, the ship, rather. They had a helicopter, a Chinook helicopter, to lift it, the whole glass container, and drop it off at the docks of Wall Street. They drove it out of the container, drove it up to Wall Street, where the press was sitting there waiting to have, where they had their press conference. They had these huge doors, I forgot which building on Wall Street, but they drove it in right on the floor. They had a full orchestra up in the balcony playing for this event. And I have all the video. You can watch it. Just do a search on Maybach on YouTube, and you can watch the whole thing. It was unbelievable.
Sounds like a Steve Rossi intro.
And it was the same way, Greg, that you were talking about. I couldn't get a good shot of the car because everybody was in and out of the car. You just couldn't get a good shot of the car.
Yeah.
What's the price point on this car going to be, Greg?
If you have to ask, you can't afford it.
Well, I know, but I was just trying to compare it to what the old ones were.
I think it's around $220 or $250 or something like
that. Try about $255.
Okay.
So less expensive than the predecessor. They were over $300, were they not?
Yeah, right.
At one point, but you know, they've been able to play with the numbers on it a bit. And because it's integrated into the Mercedes line as opposed to a separate line of its own, there is some cost savings there. But this is a logical step for the Mercedes brand to bring this ultra, uber, luxury businessman executive platform and say, hey, you want one, we've got one for you. Just give us your money, all of your money.
I got to ask, do they still have the jewelry trays and the back seat armrests? They used to have these little flip-up trays that they were velvet-lined so the gentlemen could put their cufflinks and the ladies could put their earrings. Now, I'm not sure why they needed to remove all these, but
you don't want to know.
But I felt there was a need to accommodate such desires.
Well, if you're in the back seat, it's like being in your living room.
Yeah, really.
I usually leave my cufflinks in my bedroom, but that's a whole other story.
What do we have here, Greg? Mazda, what's that?
Mazda 6. Take a good look at this 6. It has been restyled. Mazda has been wildly successful with this platform. It's a midsize. They've done a restyle on it. They've done a refresh on the CX-5. In the far corner, you can see the CX-3 behind it. Mazda is basically saying, hey, we're here to play, and we're quite serious. Their SkyActiv technology has done wonders for them in terms of sales, and they're trying to get out from underneath the shadow of Toyota and Nissan as the big giants of Japanese automakers to say, yeah, we can do this as well. A lot of attention to detail. I mean, check out the running lights, those rectangular running lights that almost look like exhaust pipes. You'll see high-end lighting treatments on these platforms as standard equipment.
Now, what's Mazda saying about this CX-3? What do they expect? Who's the demographic for that car?
Their demo is urban driver, usually early 30s, usually married, possibly with either a home or a condo, so that they have a room for themselves and friends to go out to dinner and hang out, or for family members to run around town with enough cargo space in the back that you can make it worth going to the grocery store or a short trip to Home Depot, not like Russ where he's building the deck. But
so this isn't replacing anything. This is a brand new model, right?
Well, they've had a 3 out there before, but it sort of just fell by the wayside. This is a total redo on the 3 that is just, it's the wheels are pushed so far back that there's room in the back seat for adults to be very comfortable. And I see this as a very different kind of urban crossover, a very stylish, closer to the ground crossover that people will have some fun with.
I've said for years that Mazda is the best kept secret in the automotive industry. It's built by a bunch of car guys.
I agree.
They're real car enthusiasts, and they've always put out a product that was fun to drive, that was, you know, a reliable product, and why they always floated under the radar has been beyond me. The only thing that seemed to get above the radar was the Miata.
Right.
But people are shortchanging themselves if they don't at least take a look at the Mazda lineup, because they make some really good cars.
I think Mazda may have done it to themselves, because I don't remember seeing a whole lot of commercials for other products other than the Miata.
Well, their commercials for the Miata are so memorable with Zoom Zoom. And now, if you look at their commercials now, they're reaching out using some classic footage and imagery to make their point about, you know, doing the car right. And you're right, Linda, they are car guys. Their design spirit is called Kodo. It is just really good-looking cars, well thought out, extremely well-handling cars, as we all know if you've driven them for more than 10 minutes.
Right.
How do you like the Volkswagen here? That's a Volkswagen.
I like it.
Yeah, that's a Golf.
Now, is that a concept or is that a production?
It's a concept now, but it'll probably be a production, a limited production. That'll be a 400 horsepower Golf.
Wow. Wow.
400 horsepower Golf.
With P0 tires, right?
Thank you.
The actual definition of a pocket rocket.
Yeah,
really. Then some. And they're built all in the same framework as the Jetta and everything else. It's amazing to me how they're able to get so many iterations on the same platform. This one, they've already got plans to put this on the track because, you know, Volkswagen is huge into racing. And there'll be a limited number of these available for the buyers who want to have one, who've got to have one. Expect to see them in Southern California, Arizona, warm climates. Because would you want to drive this in Michigan?
No.
Certainly not in Buffalo.
No. Certainly not Buffalo. Now, is this a four-cylinder?
No. This is, I believe it's a V6 with a turbocharger, a supercharger on it. This thing is smoking. It's the only way to describe it.
It's good looking. I can say that much. Great. Man.
Very attractive. Nicely done.
Audi. This is the H-Tron. This is their fuel cell version.
Down, Russ. Down. Down.
Russ, this is stuff. I mean, we've been looking at Audis for the last few weeks, stuff that, you know, we've been doing first looks on. When you get up close, it is just absolutely breathtaking. And the fact that this technology is available, Audi's able to say, okay, you want a regular hybrid? No problem. You want gasoline? We got you. You want electric? We got that. Oh, you want a fuel cell? Right over here, sir.
Now, are they going to produce this soon?
They're starting production, I believe, in 2 years for Europe. And from what I remember from so many press conferences, we'll probably see it in 2.5-3 years here in the U.S. as infrastructure, as Russ has pointed out, as infrastructure improves and enlarges, you'll see more of this.
Audi was just approved in California to have autonomous cars on the highway, so, you know, these driverless vehicles. So they're making a big splash in the marketplace.
As we've said before, they're coming up and they're trying to steal Mercedes' lunch and also take Lexus's marbles in certain areas. So it's getting nasty up there in the luxury range. You know, it's one of those things that, you know, you don't bring a toothpick to a knife fight.
Russ, can you tell us the price of a fill-up of a typical hydrogen fuel cell car? I mean, what is it compared to gasoline? What are we looking at?
What I have been reading and hearing is you can expect it to cost about as much as gas. You know, you're in terms of the miles you get for your buck, it's going to be about the same right now as what gasoline prices are right now. And but heck, you know, as the technology gets better, that's got to come down. That'll drop. But it's still, you know, electric. What fuel cell brings to the electric fight is range. I mean, that's right. That's range and quick charging. Quick, you know, in this case, it's not charging, but refilling the hydrogen tank. That's, you know, it's a car that you can drive to grandma's for Christmas. And where the, unless grandma lives across the street, you can't do that with an electric vehicle now. So it's not so much a big, I think, of fuel cost savings, at least it won't be initially, but it's clean, you know, all there is water vapor and as waste, and you've got range, and those are the two, you know, those are the two advantages.
And another advantage hydrogen has is you're not bound by the coast, meaning you can drive this in the Midwest. You don't have to be on the East Coast or the West Coast where you have huge populations, big cities. You can have this thing out in Utah, Montana, Arizona, and like you say, you have the range. Russ, what are you hearing about? Why is there's such a slowdown or the process of building the refueling stations, why is it taking so long when this is a vehicle that can meet all the requirements that the electric car can't?
I can't really answer that, Roosevelt. It's one of those things that the companies that have a vested interest in fuel cell technology, which is primarily the car companies, the car makers, are shoveling some serious investment into the infrastructure side of it. But there doesn't seem to be anybody yet, and when I say anybody, like what you would think of as the oil companies that would be the logical people to start putting these pumps into their these refueling stations into their already established gas stations. We're not hearing anything from Shell or Exxon or any of these saying, we're getting ready to move on this. I think as they see that the car companies are serious about producing the cars, they're going to put in the infrastructure.
So this is one of
those. If you think about it, there weren't any roads and there weren't any gas stations when they started producing cars. So
is this a chicken and egg situation?
Yeah, it's the very same thing.
What's this, Greg?
Well, first of all, Russ, before I forget, Shell has already started to embrace that. They're starting to build hydrogen stations here in Southern California. And I'm sure that we'll see more of them roll out as they figure out the ways to make it a separate pump. So it's not as dire as we think, but you're right, who's going to pull the trigger first? This is prologue. You're looking at the future design language of the Audi brand. This is a concept from Audi right now. Probably you will see some iteration of it as a real platform within a few years. Notice the floating roof line. It is one of these cars that everyone just, Audi really is getting serious. And again, they're talking about offering this with a variety of powertrains underneath the hood. So,
does Audi have a new designer?
I don't know if they have a new designer or they're just taking a different attitude toward design and just getting much more aggressive. My earliest memories of Audi were frumpy, no longer. When Russ, I thought of you when I saw this Cadillac ATS-V. Is that beautiful or what?
Sweet. I'm a huge fan of the ATS anyway. I can only imagine what the ATS-V must be like.
We're talking 400 and some odd horsepower, 400 and some odd foot-pounds of torque. There'll be a limited number available with a manual transmission. But they're talking 8 and 9 speed automatic transmissions in this thing. And you'll be able to buy one that you can take home and then take it to the track the next weekend and drive it on the track.
Now, nice. Someone had mentioned earlier about performance. It may have been you, Russ. Is this going to help them with performance?
How could it not?
Well, it's a limited edition for one thing.
Yeah, but still, that's, you need, if you're going to play in the luxury segment, you've got to have some clout. You've got to have, some cars that are
halo.
That people aspire to.
Halo cars.
Yep. And it can't do anything but help Cadillac as a brand.
Greg, what was Johann saying about Cadillac, since he's their new president or CEO?
That was almost hilarious. Johann gets up there and talks about, I'm a car guy. I'm inside the industry. I had no idea what Cadillac was capable of or doing. He admitted this to the public, that Cadillac is got some serious stuff going on there, but that no one has been, talking about it or, telling the story. He seems to be very impressed with the capability for performance vehicles, as Russ has alluded to. He's very impressed with their plans for future platforms that will elevate it back to where it should be as a supercar, as a luxury car that can compete on the world platform. And he was, had to admit, they're doing things inside that company I had no idea that was going on. And it's the same story that we've heard over and over again. We talked earlier about the North Star engine, which was a breakthrough in engine technology that it took a while before people began to realize there's something serious going on over there. He was quite pleased.
Greg,
your buddy Ed Welburn was there, smiling from ear to ear, looking at his new toy. By the way, Ed grew a full beard.
Oh, goodness. In your opinion, Greg, who should take some of these concept cars to the market, or who will take one of their concept cars to the market first?
I think Audi, you'll see the Prologue or version of it in the market within 3 years. The Toyota, yeah, they're saying 57,000 now. I think we'll see a more modified version of that Mirage within 3 years or less. There's been a lot of hints that in Detroit and New York this year, we'll be seeing real-world vehicles that were concepts not that long ago. Mitsubishi, with what they showed off today, with what they call a PHEV, I can't quite figure what the acronym is for, it'll basically take the Outlander from being, okay, yeah, to like, wow, really sharp styling. I'm sorry I couldn't get a picture of it over to you in time. It is really, really very sharp.
Hey, man, I appreciate you taking the time to sit in with us, give us our second live report from the LA Auto Show. And safe travels back. Enjoy the rest of the week out in LA, which I'm sure you will. So now we'll move into first thoughts. And our first thought car today is the 2015 Kia 900. It's the 5-liter V8, delivering 420 horsepower at 376 pound-feet of torque. The exterior color is a deep formal blue. Interior is a beige leather. Has an 8-speed automatic transmission, gets 15 miles per gallon in the city, 23 on the highway, and 18 combined. This model has an MSRP of $66,400. First thoughts, Russ?
Well, you know, with the success that Hyundai has had with the Genesis, I'm certainly not going to say, wow, who's going to spend that kind of money on a Kia? It's pricey, but I've driven this car, and I like it a lot. It certainly can compete in that price point. Will people take it seriously? I haven't looked to see the sales figures lately to see what the sales have been, but overall, I think the car is a terrific car. And the interior is just gorgeous. It's comfortable. It's roomy. There's really not a negative that I can come up with on it.
Linda?
I haven't seen this car in person. First impression looking at it is just, wow, it's a gorgeous car. When you talked about the numbers under the hood, most impressive. And following along with the lines of what Russ was saying earlier about if you're going to play in the luxury market, you have to have performance. Obviously, they have met those needs. And since the fuel economy is not what you would typically expect of most Kias, it's definitely a different kind of Kia. But I think it's telling the world that, yeah, we're serious about being a real player in the marketplace at all levels. And it looks like they've just done a really excellent job on this vehicle. It's gorgeous.
Greg.
A few years ago, I remember talking to a Kia executive about when you guys are going to come up with the big luxury car. And he said to me, well, Kia is really positioning itself as the everyday family car type platform. Obviously, someone changed their mind within their corporate offices and said, hey, let's go for it, because they saw where Hyundai was going. The advantage they have is they share mechanical platforms with the Hyundai Genesis. No problem there. From what I'm seeing, oh my gosh, this is gorgeous. This is the kind of car that I can see becoming an aspirational buy for someone right now who's in a Rio. Just say move up and up and up and up. Because if you look in between, they've got almost every mark hit. So this is like how to do it right. And I see that they're using, they've made better use of certain spaces than the Hyundai version with certain features. But yeah, go for it, guys. Go for it.
I waited quite a while to get one of these, and I was blown away when the guy delivered it to me. It's a great looking car, and the first thing I thought was Kia didn't just dip their toe in the luxury waters, they jumped in all the way with this car. I don't think this car is lacking anything that the Mercedes or the big BMWs that they can put up against this particular car. It has, like Linda was saying, it has a lot of power under the hood. It moves. It will push you back in the seat. And it's comfortable. You have something like three or four drive levels that you can just hit a button. And one of the neat things was when you put it in sport, the digital dash changed where you can see the tachometer changed to digital where you can see the numbers. The speedometer changed to digital where you can see the numbers. So each one of the different driving positions that you could put the car in, the digital dash changed. The gauges for that particular setting changed, which was to me a different feature. But overall, I think Kia did a great job with this particular car. It's more than fun to drive. It's a head turner. A lot of people didn't know what it was. They spent a lot of time, not just a quick look, I mean staring to see what this thing was. But anyway, folks,
they were just looking at you, Greg. And they thought they were just looking at your good-looking face, huh, Roosevelt?
Yeah, that's what they thought, but I said, nah. But we're on the witching hour. It's a little after 4. It's been a great show. We had some great reports from L.A. again. It's something that we want to try and do, not just at the major auto shows, but maybe take some local auto shows as we master this business hangout technology. It's something that you can do at any point in time. One of the things that I like to do with the show, and I've been playing around with some devices to do that, is actually start doing live walk-arounds where we can invite people in and they can ask me to show them a particular part of the car and we can do it as a part of the show. And you talk about having some interactivity, I think that would have some interactivity. And you know the first thing somebody wants to show is, show me the oil plug under the car. You know, but I'll be able to get down and dirty with a mobile phone and show it to them. So hey, I've tested those kinds of things. We can literally do that. I just haven't mastered it to make it smooth enough so that we can do those kinds of things. But we're bringing to the auto show, talk show world something totally different. We're giving journalists an opportunity to get their message out in front of a lot more people. In a more relaxed setting, nobody has to feel threatened. We're getting some show guests that's giving us some great information. We have some people who want to be on the show. I knew this was going to be a bad week for car company people, mainly because of the LA Auto Show. But next week, well, the first week in December, as a matter of fact, we have Dean Case from Nissan or Infiniti is going to be on. He couldn't be on this week again because of the show. But we're lining up some great guests. We're bringing in people from in and outside the auto industry. We want to get some small business people on here to talk about what they're doing, what they're driving, why they're driving. We want to do all of that good stuff. And as I mentioned earlier, we introduced our own Auto Network Wi-Fi system where we can help businesses sell more products and services to mobile shoppers in and around their place of business. This thing works. I've been playing with it for about 8 weeks. I have one installed in a local mall in South Carolina. And people who log into the free Wi-Fi hotspot that it creates, we're getting something like 90% click-through rates. 90% click-through rates. You don't get that with paid SEO or anything. 90%. The lowest I've had is 77%. It's
and how much again is that? What's the percentage again, Roosevelt?
It's 90%.
90%.
The highest 77% has been the lowest. And the great thing about it, there's only a one-time activation fee of $397. After that, you pay nothing. You can't.
But wait, there's more.
You can't beat that. And wait, there is more. As always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next week.
Adios.